Hello friends, welcome to another new session of English Literature. So friends, today's topic of discussion is Sweetness and Light from Culture and Anarchy by Matthew Arnold. Friends, you all know that Culture and Anarchy is a very important collection of essays and we very often think that it is quite difficult to understand. So in this session, I'm going to discuss it briefly so that you'll get a clear idea about the cracks of Sweetness and Light from Culture and Anarchy. So without wasting any time, let's start. So now at first we have to know that what is Sweetness and Light. So in Culture and Anarchy, Arnold used the phrase Sweetness and Light as the title of the first essay to convey that culture is free from all kinds of narrowness and stands against all the mischief men who believed in machinery. The title Sweetness and Light is first used by Jonathan Swift, who in 1704 in the Battle of Books wrote of beauty and intelligence as two noblest of things, sweetness and light. Then in 1869 Matthew Arnold made Swift's later phrase Sweetness and Light a touchstone of Victorian sensibility as the title of the first article of his Culture and Anarchy, which is widely recognized as a classic in the English language. So Culture and Anarchy contains a good deal of Arnold's critical arguments of the state of Victorian society that he saw and knew. The essays included in that work are on some provocative subjects of the age that was giving way to base materialism and going out of the fold of aesthetic culture. In the first essay, entitled as Sweetness and Light, Arnold says that sweetness and light are the two things that a culture should strive for. Sweetness is a moral righteousness and light is intellectual power and truth. So in this context, J. Dover Wilson says that Culture and Anarchy is at once a masterpiece of vivacious prose, a great poet's great defense of poetry, a profoundly religious book, and the finest apology for education in the English language. So now, let us now jump to the next section, Arnold's thoughts as a prose writer. So as an intellectual author, Arnold stands out as a preceptor of critical thoughts and judgment on the intellectual line and seems to have almost an Aristotelian attitude to different literary and cultural matters. In fact, Arnold is considered a powerful voice of interpretation of literature, particularly poetry and prose. Arnold's cultural criticism is a type of literary criticism which is related both to historical and sociological criticism. In this context, David Deitch said that Arnold himself calls the Culture and Anarchy as an essay in political and social criticism. So Arnold deeply felt that the middle classes of Victorian England, with their mammon worship, their crass materialism and euphoric complacency about their condition, can never be the proper guardian of literature and a healthy literary legacy. And their several evangelical counterparts are insensitive to aesthetic value of literature or to imaginative literature. In this ambience, culture is relegated to a limbo. And in this regard, Arnold comments sarcastically that our goal, thousands of people were saying, is the real basis of our national greatness. If our goal runs short, there is an end of the greatness of England. But what is greatness? Culture makes us ask. Greatness is a spiritual condition worthy to excite love, interest and admiration. So now after this, our next point is why Arnold pinpoints sweetness and light in the context of culture. So Arnold here in Sweetness and Light says that culture aims at the perfection which is harmonious. Perfection in which both beauty and intelligence are present. A perfection which unites the two noblest of things, namely sweetness and light. Then the author goes to the origin of culture that lies in the love of perfection. In it, two dominant desires work in harmony, the scientific passion for pure knowledge and the moral and social passion for doing well. For Arnold, culture is a study of perfection. It moves by the force, not merely or primarily of the scientific passion for pure knowledge, but also of the moral and social passion for doing good. Then Arnold, in Sweetness and Light, pinpointed religion as the greatest and the most important of the efforts by which human race has manifested its impulse to perfect itself. As Arnold says, religion, that voice of the deepest human experience, does not only enjoin and sanction the aim of setting ourselves to ascertain what perfection is, but also in determining generally in what human perfection consists.
Religion says that the kingdom of God is within man, and culture places human perfection in an internal condition. As Arnold says, culture is the indispensable aid to reach in every ideal. According to Arnold, all great literature of time and space are a storehouse of culture to dispel the miasma of materialism as well as the foolish smutchiness and insalubrious attitude of life of the English people. Arnold refers to healthy books like the books of Homer, Sophocles, Epictetus, Senancour, Goethe, Shakespeare and Milton, because the classical literature, especially the literature of the Greeks, are the constant source of Arnold's inspiration where the ideal sweetness and light can be attained. So Arnold finds sincere and genuine connection between culture and the idea of sweetness and light. His ideal man of culture is the Greek man called Euphorcus. The character of the man of culture is molded by religion and poetry. The aim of the religion is to make man perfect ethically, whereas poetry possesses the idea of beauty and of human nature perfect on all its sides. Culture has the power to prevail peace and satisfaction by killing our bestiality, by drawing nearer to the world of spirituality with the perfection. He describes that religion fails to lead us to such perfection. He submits example of Puritanism that is based on the impulse of man towards moral development and self-conquest. This perfection leads to the idea or impulse of narrowness and insufficiency. He jumps to such conclusion by judging the religious organization in terms of sweetness and light. Now Arnold goes on to say that the man of culture should have the pursuit of pure knowledge with impartial desire or passion and prevail it in society with sweetness and light for diminishing human miseries. The man of culture, Arnold says, ever aims at sweetness and light, while the man who goes against this is a Philistine. Now the question arises that who is a Philistine? So according to Arnold, the people who believe most that our greatness and welfare are proved by our being very rich, and who most give their lives and thoughts to becoming rich, are just the very people whom we call the Philistines. The great man of culture broadened the basis of life and intelligence and worked powerfully to expand sweetness and light and to make reason and the will of God to prevail. A man of culture is like a honeybee. The job of the honeybee is to suck the juice from all flowers, sweet or sour, and to make honey. So honey is sweet and liked by all in all forms. Honey has wax that is also useful to make candles which spreads light. So in this similar way, a man of culture seeks knowledge from all the departments and shares it to all. He is not a narrow-minded because such knowledge brings perfection. So his pursuit of perfection is sweetness and light. Thus, from the above discussion, it can be said that as a prose writer, Arnold is essentially a propagator of culture and faith, and believes that culture is the minister of sweetness and light, essential to the perfection of a character, and that faith is the basis of joy, hope and peace in life. As a devout follower of classicism, Arnold is opposed to the modern mechanism and rationalism, bereft of faith, conviction and liberalism. In Arnold's opinion, the pursuit of perfection is the pursuit of sweetness and light. He who works for sweetness in the end works for light, and he who works for light in the end works for sweetness also. Those who work united for sweetness and light work to make the reason and the will of God to prevail. So culture has one great opinion, the passion for sweetness and light. It looks beyond machinery, social, political and economic, and beyond population, wealth and industry, and beyond middle class liberalism, and avoids all kinds of narrowness and hatred.
So friends, that's it for today's video. Thank you so much friends for watching this video, and if you find it a bit relevant, then please like this video and don't forget to share it. And if you want to know about any topic of English literature, then please comment below and don't forget to subscribe my channel. So bye bye, see you in the next session very soon.